in German here would be hurting you, I think, or hurting me. Yeah. So I think I understood everything, though. I was also busy with this, and I think the resolution is a little bit out of control here, but can't seem to get it right. But that's kind of part of this talk, I would say. So yeah, I've been teaching and studying glitches for I'd say almost 10 years now. It's quite long, but I have been making it kind of an effort to not talk about them at all anymore, and just don't use the word glitch. It's like a sport for me, not use the word that I'm studying in my presentations. But now I was invited to give a funny talk about glitches here, because it's the end of the evening, everybody's tired, and we want to just have something that can make us go happy to our house. So to not use the word that you have to be happy about now, I will first go into just explaining it and then try to not use it anymore. So my real research right now is more about resolutions. But to study resolutions, I think it's really interesting to go, or it's maybe the most useful to do it via glitches. And glitches are kind of all the things that we don't normally want to have in our computers. So it's not very funny. It's when we are writing the spreadsheets for our children that we're going to teach. And suddenly there's this moment happening that we're looking at the spreadsheet, but we can't make out what it says. It just says like weird kind of broken imagery, and no more numbers, no more names, no more maybe anything, but just kind of this kind of stuff, the weird colors, ugly or maybe interesting. It depends on how you see it, but it's just that moment that you don't want to have. And then you have to wait what's going to happen. And maybe something comes out of it. Maybe you're going to get your spreadsheet back. Maybe you'll lose for your data forever. And so this kind of moment has been used by artists, because artists also just use trash. And for me, I will just go into a little bit of background why and how I got into this. I think it was 2005 or 2006, and I was walking in the streets of Amsterdam, which is where I live. Probably you heard that, but I was in the computer then. I'd moved to Amsterdam in 2001, and I was playing a lot of computer games already then. Actually, this is Quake 1. I was playing Quake with my. We set up a LAN network where we would play internet games together in the hall of the place where I was living. And so I knew this video game really well. I knew the sounds that were supposed to come. This video game that I used to play in my house. And I went in and I saw this. It's really hard to see now, and I think maybe because I'm going to show a lot of images, maybe it's possible to make the light a little bit less loud, or I don't know. It's not necessary to. It was broken. Quake is a first-person shooter. I think a lot of the kids play that still. And you're supposed to win. You're supposed to shoot a lot of animals or monsters, and it was impossible in this version. So I came up past this house, I saw one of my favorite video games, well, at least I heard part of it, but it wasn't playable. And I was annoyed. There was this moment of just feeling like, okay, I really like this video game, and this is just not functioning, and I want it to function, because that's how I'm kind of used to seeing this video game. And I was allowed to touch it, so I touched it, and weird stuff happened, and I didn't understand it, and I was annoyed and a little bit curious, but I went home. And really, when I came home, I just started to research and read about it, and what I learned was that it was an artwork, which is obvious now, going back to this, but back in 2005, this was not something that you would normally see, and you were not used to seeing video games as a form of art. And so, I read up on it. I wrote a master thesis about it. I wrote almost a book just about this particular, which is now a video, but what was a video game. And finally, I didn't understand it still. So that's why I'm still kind of working on this kind of research. But what I did learn, and it finally, it was a work by Jody, which is a Dutch-Belgian arts collective, was that they were using video games as a material and not as a game. So they taught me that you can do a lot more with any kind of software or hardware than it's programmed to do. And they actually made performances, and it's not like VJing, but more like audiovisual performances where they would show this, and then people would not dance to it, but they would really get into it. So sometimes in media art festivals, they actually give performances just using their kind of deconstructed, destroyed softwares and hardwares. And that's now also quite normal, but, you know, like, everybody gets used to destroying stuff. It's not something very exciting anymore, and I think destroying things has changed also in the media arts from really building things and taking them apart and showing what you can do with them also. And I think in this kind of research that I'm doing that came from Bitch Art, I think it's also not about destroying and making something new or showing the things that you can do, but actually even going further. And that's why I call it resolutional research. It's because also showing what these kinds of video games, what kind of rules they're built upon, but also what these kind of rules exclude as possibilities. So I'm gonna go and kind of show you some resolutions that made us unaware of other things that, if those resolutions didn't exist, what you could also do with the data. But before that, I wanted to show just a little bit of the other work that I've been doing before I got here. And one of those things was videoscapes. In videoscapes, I started to work with sound artists that use their machines in ways that were not supposed to be used. For instance, Commodore 64, which is kind of those old video game consoles, which I don't think that people that you are teaching now are really necessarily interested in. Maybe they're interested in NES consoles and Game Boys still, but Commodore 64 has come kind of out of fashion for young kids. But for me, it was still very interesting back then. I was kind of seeing how far you can push these machines. So friends of mine, they would kind of make their own software for Commodores. They would make sounds that you could not program via normal tracker softwares. And so then people would come to these parties where they would actually play 8-bit music, and they would make sounds, and people would listen to them and would say, wow, I've never heard any of the sound coming from a Commodore. And so they would have conversations about how they push the hardware. And that was, for instance, by pushing the sound chip and getting the sound chip to kind of get buggy and then make sounds that were not supposed to come out of the sound chip. And then it wouldn't sound like a Commodore anymore. And then I started to translate these kinds of effects into video effects. And what I did in Videoscapes was really a lot of videos that were using exploits of sound elements and translating them to video elements. And it kind of was already in a sense of what Schaefer is also talking about. He was talking about people not really listening to instruments anymore, because we all know what a piano is supposed to sound like. And we know if we're going to be in a classical concert that has a piano and a string quartet and all these things, we kind of know before they start playing what kind of music they're going to play, so we just sit down and we know what's going to happen, and we're not really listening, we're just kind of recognizing things that we already know. And so Schaefer was saying, okay, we need to really learn what it is to listen again, and so we have to open up our earlids. And then I thought, okay, that's interesting, earlids opening, but it's the same for video games and for any kind of other visual element that these days we're going into this digital environment and we know what we're going to get, and we're not really watching what's happening anymore. We're not asking the questions of how these machines are functioning, but what's beyond that functioning, really. And so I was starting to think about how can I make people kind of engage their software and their hardware and really start watching again. So start watching what's beyond the spreadsheet. Friends of mine, for instance, they make performances just in spreadsheets, and they put dancing dinosaurs and all this kind of stuff. And it's really just to show again, if we're gonna open a spreadsheet, what are we engaging with? And so I started researching this kind of stuff in the videoscapes. This is to say, I'm gonna skip a slide here, I'm gonna maybe also say why this, I think this is important, is because, you know, a lot of people here, and especially also when I was young, my parents, I look young, it's because of the blue hair. No, but my parents wouldn't let me use the computer at all until I was maybe moved out of the house. And it was because they were afraid that I would break it because the computer was breakable. And I was taught some kind of like fear of a computer. You're not supposed to touch it because if the kids touch it, they're gonna break it. And that's how I learned how to engage computers, was with a certain fear of this is very easy to destroy. So I really had to learn how to not be afraid of destroying the computer, which is actually really hard these days to really destroy it. Beyond the fact that you have some kind of tank around your machine and it's now throwable, but also, you should show that. That's amazing. It's for iPads if you want to throw your iPad. But also, it's really hard to really break your computer. If you really want your Word to crash, then you actually have to kind of really do some stuff to make it crash. So, what I learned was, I had this thing, or where did I put it? Ah, here. Was, how to engage data again, and how can I really make my machine malleable and use it as a material. And so one work that really inspired me is a work by BFlix. This is a work that I had to build with John Sedrum and Nick Rees in a festival that I organize every year. Well, actually, we haven't organized it last year, but it's in Chicago. It's called gli.tc/h. And in this work, BFlix and Scott, he just sent me data. And I really had to think, what is this work about? Because I was never supposed to use data anymore. I was just used everything that was already information. So I really, information is data that has some kind of value with it, right? I don't know how far, for me it was really hard to follow everything in German, so I don't know how far along in this whole conversation I'm just tickling brains that are tired. But anyway, so what I got was a string of data, and can you do this thing again where you hold the thing? Okay. I got a string of data, and then he said, okay, so you now have to put it, you have to put your data in the hardware, or around the hardware. So put it on the screen, and put it around, and if you render it right, you might get to see the image. If you put it around the right algorithm, So what I learned was, okay, this is actually, this is a very boring thing in a way, but for me it opened up everything. But suddenly I saw that every image was really made out of data. And you can make of any kind of data, you can make any kind of image if you put it in the right format. So if you put an algorithm on any kind of data, it can become anything if you put it in the kind of protocol that makes it what you want it to be. This is a very weird, boring thing, but it became really interesting, because what I learned was that, what I learned was that I can actually open my Photoshop documents in, for instance, Audacity, and I can listen to my images, and I can put a Photoshop filter on my sounds, and I can get effects that I've never seen. It's not the Photoshop effects that I'm used to. I could show you, anything in my computer, I can engage it in many, many ways. There's a lot of softwares that make it impossible to engage data in a particular way. They only make you engage it in one specific way. For instance, an image has to be opened in a preview or in any kind of image processing software. But if you find the right holes and the right moments where it's not completely structured of how to engage it, then suddenly you can open anything in many, many ways. I can give you a fast example, maybe that's very useful. Because this is what I think for everybody that uses their devices every day, maybe the people that grow up now, they'll be living around their devices 24/7, so they'll never be out of it. They don't learn the materiality of data anymore. They're not even aware that anything can be anything on their computer. They're just aware of using them in one specific way. An image is an image, and you're not supposed to play with that, because that's dangerous. Because we are teaching them that it's dangerous to do other stuff. Or, I hope we're not, but that's how I've been learned to do it. So, let me show you, for instance, this is a nice image. This is old people, but it's actually a group of very interesting old people. It's from was going to show this image, it's gonna come back later. It's a JPEG image, and actually I'm gonna save it real quick as a BMP. Which is here. I'm not giving you a class on how to re-save your images. This is my freehand, so it'd be really easy. So here, this text editor, for instance, gives me the possibility to just open any file as a different kind of data. Which, for the text editor, it's already information. But for us, it's just data. It's weird data. And this is a BMP file as data. Now, a BMP file, I can edit it in a text editor. I can just put all this stuff around and copy-paste it and save it here. File. Save. Then I can close it. And then here, I can open it again. Wait, that one. This one. And now you can see that by just editing it in another text editor, and it's quite hard to see, I guess, behind me here, I just edited it a little bit. And so you see, at some point when you play with this, I do it now really fast, but it's kind of visible, right? Here, you see that this line is now realigned somewhere else, and here wasn't the best, because black and white images are quite hard to see the difference now. And I did their feet, which is also not the most exciting part of this image. But what you see is that data, see this the original there, is very fluid, and I can do many, many things with it. And this is a very boring example, because I just made a BMP a little bit different. But actually, there's a lot of exciting stuff that you can do. You can listen to rainbows. But I think that's exciting. That's just one of those things. Once you start to listen to rainbows, it's actually, and you can watch the sounds also, for instance, in Audacity. And things become much more than just the thing on your computer screen. And that became for me really an eye-opener. I'm gonna... Yes. So, that's this work by Bflix. And Bflix has retired his artist career. But I hope he's coming back someday to make more of these beautiful work. But I'll always mention his name for a second. I have a little error in my machine, so I have to always restart a thing twice for some silly use. So about resolutions. Now most of the resolutions that we're working with these days, when I say resolution, we're all thinking about screens and screen sizes, so 1024 by 800, or you know, if it's HD, we're all now taught to think in maybe 1280 by 720, because that's cool and pay more money for that. But resolution is much more. In war, for instance, a resolution would be a treaty between two countries. Sometimes they go wrong. We've noticed that the last couple of years. But a resolution is really just an agreement of terms between two or multiple parties. In computers, there's always many parties that have things at stake to make things function. And they make kind of a resolution to make it work in this way because of a certain reason. For instance, the machine, the computer, has to work faster. Or we need to see more pixels because we want to have a crisp image. So then there's different things at stake, and the resolution is edited for this kind of reason. But at the same time, it's just a settlement, and it's a compromise. So there's also kind of always somebody or some part of the resolution that has to give in a bit to make the other thing function better. It's kind of the economical treaty between resolutions. Now, some people think that resolutions are bad. I think, for instance, or they talk about resolutions with kind of like this kind of bitter taste. In machines, resolutions always have to get better. We're thinking about this horizon of resolution where all the treaty, all the partners in the resolution get the best out of it, because we have somewhere an unlimited idea of something that you can put. If I'm becoming really abstract, let me know, because I know you've been in this room for many, many hours. But anyway, there's artists that work with this. For instance, Graham Harwood and Matsuko Yokoko, who have made the evil resolution or the evil media. This is actually called the Evil Media Distribution Center, which is where they show all the evil media and their gray resolutions. They call them gray because they're boring. For instance, Anna, who would be here, she has done a part of this work. She showed punch cards, and punch cards as the beginning of early computing, and how bad punch cards can be. Or Prozac, which is a medicine that has to follow certain rules. And we could make much better Prozac, but now economical resolutions make it impossible to make better Prozac. And all these rules are organized by the ISO. And this is the old people that I just showed, and I just glitched, kind of. The ISO is the International Organization of Standardization. And this is one of those things that I think are really beautiful, is in 1926 already, it was the ISA at that point, also an organization for standardization. They came together and they started to organize the world into standards and resolutions. Because of the Second World War, they had to break up. But in 1947, they came back as the ISO. And since that moment, this group of old people, and more new people have come, but you can see it's nice because there's almost only men at that point. They have been organizing now with 164 countries, all the rules of how everything in the world is functioning, from film rolls to bricks that we build our houses from screws, which are everywhere, how they're supposed to look and how they're supposed to function. I think this is something, we're free to make our own screws, luckily, still. But there's also a lot of rules that the ISO sets that we're not getting out of, and there's a lot of rules that we're not aware of that they're set. And this is what I think where it gets more interesting. Question is, for instance, when or have you ever seen a video or a film that didn't have four corners? I mean, it's normal, right? Because it comes from a historical background where a celluloid had four corners. And so it's a kind of an economical standard to have four corners in your movies. But why, since we have computers that have, I mean, they have options to make corners everywhere in every video, why does a video have to have four corners? Why not, as you can see here, which is a work by John Settrum, it's actually multiple works by John Settrum overlaid on top of each other. Why do we not have just videos that have multiple corners? And why do we never think about that as a video artist? Why am I supposed to make videos that have four corners? It's like the worst solution that you can imagine is having to, as a video artist, always work into this frame. And it's really quite scary once you notice that that is what's the reality, is that all videos have four corners, but it's not necessary anymore. So a resolution, and the resolutions we're working with, have made us blind, have completely made it impossible for us to see that there's much more possible. And it's hard to find these things that are possible also, because, I mean, you are kind of blind for it, but at some point you can start to train yourself and see what is also possible besides this. For instance, this is a work that I did a couple of years back, which is called the Vernacular File Formats. And in that work, I studied all the languages of compression. So there's many image compressions that are built for different kind of events, such as, for instance, JPEG 2000, which is built for medical reasons. If you're gonna have kids that throw something, oh, this is a horrible thing to say. If you have kids that you work with that throw something sharp, I was going to say. No, this, but if something happens in your work and something gets into your skin and you have to take it out in the hospital, you need to take a photo, an x-ray, of knowing what is in your skin. So it needs to be a good photo that functions for this reason. So they built JPEG 2000, for instance, a medical image standard, to make no sharp artifacts in the whole photo. So there's reflets on top of it. This is actually a GIF, so that's not a good example. But up here, in the middle up, that's the JPEG 2000. They put reflets on top of it, so there's no artifacts from the photo itself. If you see a sharp object in a photo that is taken in the hospital, it is really a sharp object. It's not a photo artifact, something where something went wrong. So all these kind of standards that are used the most, you can see here, because this is my face actually, but you recognize me, and especially because the resolution is very weird right now. But these are the 9 most used image file formats, and they all have kind of very beautiful historical stories of why they became what they are now. But at the same time, I mean, when somebody asks me to send them a photo of my artwork, for instance, the museum in Amsterdam, they ask me, okay, we want to print your artwork and we need a JPEG. They actually effectively ask me to send them an image that has deleted some of the information. Because they work with standards that, you know how people say MP3s are really cool because you can download, I mean, in the past we all downloaded MP3s because they were downloadable fast. It's because they delete particularly of the highs and the lows, and so they only show what we can hear as humans really well. And so they have this kind of lossy compressions, we call that. And it's just because they are smaller and easily to use. And so a lot of these compressions, and especially compressions that, for instance, Musea-esque, they actually have a lot of information that deleted. So they asked me to delete parts of my artworks. And so I got a little bit sad of people always asking me, can I have an image of your artwork with some deleted information, because we don't use that information anyway. So that's when I started to make this vernacular file formats and make people aware of how these kind of languages of file formats work. And from that, a friend of mine, Johan Larsby from Sweden, worked with me to make a software to educate people about the languages of file formats. And from that, something really beautiful happened. Kim Asendorf from where he's from. He's from Germany, though. You can hear that also by the name. He said, okay, that's cool, Rose. Now you made all these file format resolutions and you explained how they're working and the languages beyond them and how you can use them, but you're still stuck in a system. What if we could make our own compressions that don't conform to any ISO standards? And so from that, a new software came, which is Xtrafile. And Xtrafile gives you just your own options to make your own image compressions and to choose yourself what kind of information of your images you're not kind of interested in and you can delete. So now I can send a museum if it really functions, but nobody wants to function outside of a system. So in that sense, it's still kind of an artwork, but it gives me some kind of power again over the materiality of things that I work with every day. But now I can send them images that would have information that normal compressions wouldn't deem interesting or useful to transmit. I'll give one more example of something I've been really obsessed with for the last couple of months, kind of an artifact fetish, which is it's called rolling shutter. As again, it's really hard to see here, which is kind of a shame. I can give another example. I have some hanging out here. This is a very nice one. This is a video from an aeroplane taken by somebody that had their GoPro and was going to go skydiving, but the camera decides to skydive before the actual guy or woman. So what happens is, falls. And because it's falling so fast, but the camera still has a particular frame rate, the frame rate and the amount of rolling of the camera in the air doesn't align. And so the camera has to start interpreting what it sees, because it's moving faster than the amount of frames that it can process. And so what you get is this artifact, which is called rolling shutter. And so it's a problem of a resolution of the amounts of frames that is in the moment, or that is, I mean, there's all there, it has to, I see we're getting at the funny part, because I had to show some funny things. But that's an artifact. Now, of course, this is an artifact in which a machine shows that it's just not perfect, because no machine is perfect. And so artists have always kind of tried to use this kind of imperfection in their artworks and make art of that. And I wasn't sure how technologically savvy or interested you would be, because it's always hard to come somewhere and not knowing where you're getting. At first, I hope I brought my adapter. I'm seem to have not brought it, actually. Let me see in the past. Might have. Yeah, okay, cool. So, what happens if I get the magic out of my... artists tend to exploit and show also these things that machines have tried to make invisible. I mean, we tend to not try to watch anything that has to do with a rolling shutter. If you're, I mean, when I'm really tired at a conference like this, and it's the last thing, and I can't really keep my eyes open, but I have to, I start to do this. I don't know, here it's not, so I'm not giving you any hints now, but there's a lot of moments that you're watching the projector, and then you start to see the green, the blue, and the red images flash, so you start to see the spinning rainbow effect. Do you know this? You must have these projectors also in Germany, so I know you know this. Make this function. Yeah, maybe it's a little bit fragile because it's American. Ha ha ha. Okay, so this is let me see if it's turning. Yes, okay. So this is a machine that's designed by Pete Edwards. Casper Electronics. It's a Nova drone. It's an audio-visual synthesizer. And it works with the same effect that you saw here. It works with the frequency of the LED. This is a military LED, so it's really fast. Most military people use the best LEDs. And then it works with, because, you know, it has audio-visual interface. Sorry, I'm... Yeah, this one. So many little components. Build it up. So, here it is. And now I can turn on the sound here. Opa. It's just show you this via my this is also how you can do a performance, how media artists perform. Turn the sound off also, because that was very pleasant for just a second. There. So, what does this machine do? It plays with the amount of the shutter frequency of your camera, which can be an iPhone, for instance, but it can also be my webcam right here, and the frequency of the LED. And they don't line up. The LED actually bleeps faster than... my bad webcam in my computer. And so it starts to show this by, again, this interpretation that you also saw in the rolling shutter. And, well, this is just a still, but what you see is a very beautiful, controllable, just lines that the webcam starts to interpret. And from this, you can do very nice audiovisual performances that I try to do, but this setup is just a little bit short in the cables. Another, I will, this is actually a really beautiful example because we're in Germany. How am I for time, Björn? Oh, Björn is in the computer. How am I for time? 10 minutes, okay. I started to make a lot of works, but I started to show them in really boring ways, because every time I did a performance, it wasn't like me throwing stuff around the machine right now, but it was me just standing in behind the computer and pushing the buttons like media artists do these days. They stand like this. And I got a little bit bored of that and also a bit annoyed with myself. So I started building an environment in which I could show my work that wasn't normal, like as in a keyboard normal. And I did it in Unity. And these days I try to teach, at least every time I teach a class, to get some people together to start to work with Unity, which is an environment in which you can make kind of build 3D environments, sometimes video games, depends on how smart your students are. But I noticed that it's so easy that actually every time I throw the kids into the situation, which is people 16 years old, within a day they can build a whole environment. So it's actually, they learn some JavaScript and they can really use the materiality of the code and of the algorithm of the things they use in the environment. For instance, I had some kids, they would use one sound. They would make all the blocks. They would program all the blocks. No, they would make one sphere. They would sonify the sphere by listening at the sphere, the 3D sphere, in Audacity. So loading up a 3D element in Audacity, and then from that start to build a whole environment just by sonifying objects and re-translating them again into a 3D environment. So what you got was a very weird sound space in which you could navigate the same thing every time, but just sonified and then put back into the 3D environment. I thought that by showing my work, and why I got that and wanted to show that was because I made I go back to the beginning where I showed Jody's piece, which inspired me to do all this research into the materials. And I built my own video game, and it was actually reviewed by Wired Germany. And they gave me a very beautiful review, which was, als videospiel werk compress process and flop. Zu irritierend, geradezu verstörend is die Erfahrung. So how they review, and which is kind of what I did in 2005 when I saw the Jody piece. They were annoyed with what I made because they thought it was a video game. They also reviewed it in Wired as a video game in the video game section. So my audiovisual environment became an annoying video game, which I thought was, I mean, I was kind of asking for that because I did the same to somebody in the past. But it's still, you can see this dogma of something is made inside a software, so it must be this. And they don't go and look into, and Wired is one of the biggest magazines still. So it's very, very beautiful that they still have these complete dogmatic ways of talking about something. Yes, it's made in Unity. It doesn't need to be a video game. And so what I always try to teach my students is, you know, you can use a software also beyond what the software was programmed to do. And then you can get really surprising things. Such as this weird Nova drone or a bad Wired review, but actually Wired put the attention to make a review. That's, I mean, who gets bad reviews anymore that didn't ask for it? So I think I'll stop here. And thank you very much for your attention so late in the evening. And good luck.
A lot, very good.